Good afternoon to all of you from the North Cape University, and welcome back to the North Cape Masterclass, a series of talks wherein you get to listen to eminent thinkers, scholars, and leaders sharing their perspectives on what's going on in the world and what it means to you as a future professional. University has a unique place in human society as an institution that has the power to shape the minds and transform people fundamentally. And this power comes from its people. Great universities are magnets for the finest students and the faculty. Over the past 25 years, the North Cape University has been such a place, a meeting ground of talented students and faculty, that our graduates are welcomed in leading global companies in the world and top universities abroad should come as no surprise. At NCU, we take a deep interest in the future of mankind. Take a look at the specializations we offer in engineering, management, and law. From artificial intelligence to augmented reality or virtual reality, cybersecurity, gaming, cloud computing, to business analytics, digital marketing, and latest trends in law and jurisprudence, we cover it all. We take great pains to offer you a degree that will matter in future, and that makes us a top university. This intent also drives our recent collaboration with Arizona State University, the leading US university. Our partnership is exclusive of its kind in India in terms of coverage, breadth, and depth, all designed to give you a degree that will be valued in your hands for the rest of your lives. Dear students, in this series, we have been talking about the impact of technology in the society and how this is shaping future careers. Storytelling has always fascinated human beings. It is through stories that we get to know people, get into their lives and their experiences. Epics like Ramayana and Mahabharata survive for more than 5,000 years because they are such powerful stories. Stories help us stay anchored to our times and our culture. They also help us learn about the past, present, and the future. And when it comes to storytelling, there is no medium more powerful than films. In this session, you will hear from someone who has been in the business of films. Let me introduce our guest. Mr. Chandresh Daftari is the regional director at PVR Cinemas. He manages a portfolio of 247 screens in 59 theaters across 29 cities in India. He has a career spanning real estate economics, asset management, business development, and cinema exhibition for more than 20 years. Prior to joining PVR Cinemas, he was the chief operating officer at ECT Digital Cinemas, ESL Group. He has an MBA in finance from MGM Institute of Management in Mumbai. He will speak on topic cinema industry, global and Indian perspective. As always, and write your questions and responses in the chat. Chandresh, welcome to the North Cape University virtually. And over to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much for the wonderful introduction and having me for this session to interact with all the students of North Cape University. Truly looking forward to this being an interactive session and interacting with all the students. So what I would do, Dr. Padalkar, is I would break this session into three parts. First part, I would run through a brief presentation which will give a good perspective to everyone on the cinema industry as a whole, with a both global and Indian perspective in mind. After that, I would like to interact and share my perspective, my real life experiences throughout my professional journey of more than two decades. And lastly, would be happy to take any of the questions that you may have or any of the students may have. So if you allow me, I would like to share my screen and run the team through the whole PowerPoint presentation.
That's absolutely fine.
So I represent PVR, which is one of the largest exhibition company in the country with the portfolio of almost 800 and 50 odd screens across the length and breadth of this country. We also ventured pre-pandemic, we ventured out of the country, setting up the first multiplex outside the country in Sri Lanka. We manage the largest portfolio of screens all across, with presence across more than 70 cities across the country. Now, the reason why this is of great significance, you know, it's important for each one of you to get the complete perspective of the cinema industry as a whole, because that gives you a view on how big the addressable market is across the country. So I'll move on to the next slide. This is, friends, this is the flow of the presentation. I'm going to talk of the global trends in the cinema industry, followed by the Indian scenario on the exhibition business space. PVR's presence across the cinema industry, brief dynamics of the industry, and how the P&L is stacked up for the cinema industry as a whole. So if you see this slide, you know, presently there are roughly about 200,000 cinema screens across the world. Now, when I break it up across major economies, you know, what we've done here in this slide is that broken up the screen density given the population of each of the major economies. So if you see US, which has been one of the largest market for the film trade, US has roughly 125 screen billion of population. Spain, UK, Germany, by and large, if you see the European market as a whole, the entire European market has a density of roughly about anywhere between 60 to 70 screens per million of population. China, over last couple of decades, have really grown pretty fast in terms of the overall screen additions. And China presently stands at roughly 30 screens per million of population, with the kind of growth that the country has attained over last two decades. This economies, you know, China, as you all know, is the most populated country that we have in the world, followed by India. India right now is only at about 6 screen per million of population. Now that takes the total screen count at roughly about 8,800 cinema screens that we have across the country. The reason why this is of importance is that it gives us the view, it gives us the perspective that how the exhibition market, the kind of opportunity that lies ahead in terms of growing the whole exhibition infrastructure piece across the country, the fact that there is enough room for growth, easily this 6 can become 10 to 12 screens per million of population with the kind of infrastructure that's gonna get built up over a period of time in the country. And we see enough traction at the ground level with the traditional brick and mortar malls being developed across the length and breadth of the country. The fact that PVR has been into this business for over two decades and has presence only in 70 cities also goes to show the kind of huge opportunity that lies ahead in terms of expanding the footprint all across the country. So friends, if you see the breakup of the screens that we have across the country, right now there are, of the 8,800 odd screens that I spoke about, the split of the screen is the roughly 3,000 plus screens are in the multiplex space and 5,600 odd screens are in the single screen space. The definition of multiplex is that any complex having two screens or more is technically defined multiplex complex, and any cinema which is a standalone cinema is defined as a single screen cinema in our parlance. If you see the multiplex presence that we have in the country today, almost 85 to 90% of the multiplexes that we have are all part of the large malls. We are one of the large anchor tenants in the mall, one of the many tenants, but clearly one of the major footfall driver that you see in the malls in today's time. This slide talks of the PVR journey over last 2 weeks. PVR is a company which was which started with the first four-screen multiplex in Delhi called Anupam Cinema in the year 1997. Over the course of last 23 plus years that PVR has grown to become numero uno in this exhibition space, you would see that in this whole journey, PVR has attained the kind of growth because of PVR growing both organically and inorganically in this space. The first 10 years of the journey from 1997 till 2008, it took us almost 9 to 10 years for PVR to reach the milestone of 100 screens. But if you see the next decade, which is from 2008 till 2018-19, which is where the organization achieved stupendous growth, which was a culmination of both organization choosing to grow organically as well as inorganically. This is also the time where PVR had acquired three exhibition companies in the market, which helped the organization achieve this kind of growth. The first acquisition was done by PVR in the year 2012, which was a cinema brand called Cinemax, which was based out of the western part of the country. 2016 is when PVR acquired DT Cinemas, and also with the acquisition of DT, we touched a milestone of touching 500 screens across the country. And 2018 is when PVR acquired Satyam Cinemas, which is a south-based chain with roughly 80-odd screens. Right now, as we speak, as of today, PVR has roughly 850 screens all across the country and counting. This is the journey. This is how PVR has progressed. If you see the graph, you'll realize that the organization has achieved stupendous growth in the last decade, from 160 odd screens that we had in 2012 till 849 screens that we have in fiscal 21. This slide shows you the kind of geographic presence that PVR has achieved over a period of time. One thing, friends, that we have been extremely mindful is to ensure that we have a uniform growth across the length and breadth of the country. If you see the screen density that PVR today has, it's equally present across the geographies in the country. Right now, happy to share with you that we have 1/3 screens in south, almost 1/3 in the north and the eastern market, and about 30% screen in the western part of the country. So pretty uniform growth. Going forward also, as we grow, the growth would be pretty much uniform across the geographies, and clearly the objective is to add more cities to the kitty. Business per se has been extremely experiential. Going forward, we strongly believe as an organization that it's no more about the traditional brick and mortar that cinemas traditionally were. Going forward, the business has to be extremely experiential, which is the reason why PVR within the exhibition space have kind of expanded into multiple brands. We have a value cinema brand called PVR Utsav. We have a value cinema brand called PVR Talkies. We have the most premium brand called PVR Director's Cut. So all in all, what I'm trying to say here is that PVR caters to all these segments of the society. PVR has sold almost 100 million tickets in the fiscal year 1920, pre-pandemic. And this has come through varied forms of audiences that PVR caters to. Today, PVR caters to audience who has the paying capacity of as low as 80-90 rupees a ticket, going to the most premium format where we charge almost 2,000-2,500 for the cinema ticket as well. I'm sure each one of you would have been to some of the PVR cinemas in all the cities, depending on which city you come from. The second great, friends, that you see is the kind of premiumization that PVR has done over a period of time. We realized that going forward, if one has to really thrive in the cinema business, one has to focus more on making the cinema as experiential as possible. What PVR has done in terms of ensuring that we create that wow factor, we make the cinema as experiential as possible, we've invested heavily on creating premium format, whether it's in terms of having cinemas with all recliner seats or having cinemas with a special format with a large thrust on the technology, which is a 4DX cinema, larger than life concept, which is IMAX cinemas, cinemas catering to young adult children audience. Basically, it's a playhouse. All in all, you know, we have had multiple formats, which has really helped the business achieve this kind of level. If you see on the right, extreme right-hand side, you would see the kind of split that the business has. We play varied number of movies. You know, in India, we exhibit more than 2,000 movies. Almost 60% of the business in the PVR Kitty comes from the local Hindi content, which is what we famously call it as the Bollywood content. Roughly 16% comes from the Hollywood market, all the Hollywood titles, all the English titles that gets imported in the country and gets exhibited in our cinemas. And roughly 25%, 1/4 of the business comes from the regional content. Now, what I mean by regional content is all the movies which are made in the local language, which is your Tamil, Telugu, Marathi, Bengali, Punjabis of the world. Right now, that business constitutes about 1/4 of the total business that the industry achieves. This slide clearly depicts the kind of growth that the business have achieved over a period of time. Over the last 10-year period, if you see, the huge number of titles that has grown across regional language, across Hindi, as well as in the English side as well. The reason why the growth in the title has been to this level is because of the infrastructure growth. Clearly, 2 decades back, there were no multiplexes in this country. I'm sure Dr. Padalkar, we belong to a generation, you know, who grown up watching movie in single screen. You guys largely, are part of the generation who grown up watching movies in multiplexes. Clearly, it's the growth in the infrastructure which has seen more number of niche movies that's getting made and getting exhibited all across. And India, I keep saying this, that we are a country of huge film buffs. It's a cricket and film-loving nation. And India has great storytellers. As Dr. Padalkar also spoke about the Ramayana and Mahabharata. We have been country of great storytellers. So clearly, this depicts the kind of growth that the industry has witnessed over a period of time. A broader perspective of the business is stacked up. If you see our industry, the total business generated from the filmed entertainment space in the year 2019 was roughly about 18,000 crore. Now, out of this 18,000 crore, the split of that 18,000 crore is that 2/3 of the total business, 2/3 of 18,000 crore, which is 12,000 crore, comes from the domestic theatrical business. And 1/3 comes from the remaining activities. And what I mean in ancillary activities is how the producers would monetize the rights of the film. When the film gets made, it's first exhibited in the theaters, and then the producers monetize the same content by playing that content across satellite channels, across digital mediums, and ancillary activities. By monetizing that, 1/3 of the revenue comes. But even today, 2/3 of the revenue comes from exploiting the movie on the domestic theatrical circuit. So 12,000 crore is the total turnover, is total size of the domestic trade in the country today. And if you see the split of that, and this is the split not for PVR, but generic industry-wide split that we have, of the 12,000 crore business which gets generated, roughly 40% of that 12,000 crore comes from the Bollywood industry. 13% comes from the English titles. And the rest is split between the regional content, with clearly Tamil and Telugu taking the big fair share of the market. The reason why Tamil and Telugu is so strong, friends, is that even today, single screens are in a fairly dominant position in the southern part of the market. Of the previous slide that you guys have seen, that India has about 5,600 screens, I would reckon that more than 3,000 out of that 5,600 screens would only be there in the 5 southern states that we have in the country. This slide will broadly talk of what kind of revenue is accrued in the business. Typically, if you see the cinema business, we have 4 main types of revenue. the largest being the box office revenue, which is coming by monetizing. Every ticket that we sell to our customers, the money, the revenue that we earn with the sale of cinema tickets is what is called as a box office revenue. All the income generated out of the F&B items that we sell out of the concession area is generated from the F&B sales, which is what is captured in the F&B revenue. Third and the very important stream for our industry is the advertisement and sales revenue. All the advertisements show that you guys see, you know, before the start of the movie, during the interval, all the off-screen marketing collaterals that gets exhibited is captured in what we call it as the advertisement revenue. And fourth and the last stream of revenue for the business is the money that we generate out of other activities. The convenience fee that you pay by selling the tickets online, the 3D glasses that you buy whilst watching the 3D movies, and all other kind of incomes is generally captured as the other income. These are typically four streams of revenue that the exhibition business has presently. The split of the 100 rupee that the exhibition business earns is that 50% of our total revenue. PVR roughly had PVR is a listed company. Fiscal 1920, we had a revenue of roughly about 3,000 crore. 50% of that business comes from ticketing sales. Roughly 30% of the total 100 rupee comes from, so 30% of the 3,000 crores. That makes almost PVR as a 1,000 crore F&B company. 30% of the total sales comes from by the sale of food and beverage. Roughly, there is an equal split between the ancillary service, other income, and the advertisement revenue, which is both at 11%. So this will give you a perspective on what the broad level of income dynamics are. So let's try and see what have we learned from this, you know, over a period of time. Dr. Pagalkar, this was a very brief presentation that I had put forward only to give a perspective to students on the cinema industry as a whole. Friends, what I would like to also talk to you about is the whole journey. You know, you guys are pursuing your undergraduation. You guys would be kind of, Dr. Pagalkar briefed me that in the North Cape University, it has an intake of roughly about 1,000 odd students, broken up almost 50% into engineering and remaining 50% is between the law graduate and the management graduate. So clearly, you know, guys, you guys are pursuing your undergraduate with a specialization. Just to share my learnings, you know, over a period of time, when I completed my management studies, I was pretty unsure of as to what field should I take. All I had studied, one of the reasons why I chose to pursue my MBA was during my graduation days when I was of your age. I had started working immediately after completing 12th standard. I was working as a part-timer in a stockbroking company. Intent was clearly to make that extra buck and take care of my own pocket money. With that intent, I started working for a stockbroking company. Whilst working with the stock market community, I developed the fancy for equity research. You know, somehow I caught up a fancy with the stock market. And that's when I realized that if I want to really make my career on the in the stock market, particularly within the stock market, which is a broad field, you know, equity research is something that I wish to do. I'll need to get into some kind of specialization. Now, what that specialization would be? So, of course, I had multiple options after my graduation. I had the option of either doing my chartered accountancy or doing my MBA, CFA, which were the three prominent courses available at that point in time. This I'm talking of mid-90s. So I chose to do my MBA with specialization in finance with a clear intent of taking up a job in equity research. I've done my MBA from a university based out of Mumbai, from a 96, I'm a 96-98 batch pass out. Now, unfortunately, the irony is that the year in which I passed out or I completed my MBA and I started looking out for a job, that was a year when the whole Asia was under a deep economic crisis. All of you would not have been born in the 90s, but 97, 98, friends, also happens to be a year when the entire Asia Pacific region was passing through one of the worst economic crises that the region had faced. And clearly there were no jobs which were available. Stock market had tanked. Research was something where people were not recruiting anyone in the research market. So what next could one do? I started scouting for jobs because clearly, you know, I mean, I was not a chooser where I could have chosen to be in a particular field of my wish. So I chose to be in the entertainment field. So I got interviewed in Zee Telefilms in the year 1998, which was one of the largest broadcaster that we had in the country those days. Now, what made me decide to join the broadcasting sector was the sheer size of the industry. The reason why I'm telling you, friends, this is that over a period of last over two decades that I've had my professional journey, there are four important mantras that I have practiced throughout my professional career. The first and foremost is you got to love what you do. It's very important, friends, that during your professional journey, let me just stop sharing the screen. Yeah. It's so very important, friends, that you realize what is the area that gives you the most satisfaction. What is the area that you love doing the most? Doesn't matter. You guys must have chosen to get into law field, engineering field, XYZ. Multiple things would have played at the back of your mind whilst deciding which particular field you want to take. Kabhi ho sakta hai ki yaar dosto se shala masura kar liya, kisi relative se baat kar li, aur kisi field mein ghus gaye. After getting into a particular field, if you realize that yaar maza nahi aa raha, you're not liking what you're doing, and maybe you realize that I've taken a program in law, but maybe law is not my cup of tea. I would have been better doing something in finance. Or maybe you got into finance and you, after a certain time, realized that maybe I was better continuing with some kind of specialization in the engineering. My suggestion, my advice to each one of you is that doesn't matter. Don't be afraid of making mistakes. What's important in life is having realized that if at all there is a mistake that we made, how diligent and mindful are we in correcting that mistake in a timely manner is something which is extremely important and something which will decide your career going forward. So please be mindful of that. In case if you guys feel that there is something wrong that we've done, believe you me, it's a long life ahead in front of you guys. There's life always gives enough opportunity to take corrective measures, but it's extremely important that you guys love what you do. If you don't love what you do, believe you me, it would be extremely difficult for you to be successful in your professional career. Whether you work for any organization or you become an entrepreneur wanting to start your own business, believe you me, it's so very important to love what you do. And for you to realize what you love, it's all about introspection. You don't need to look at others' success stories. There are umpteen number of success stories that we see. You know, we've surrounded people where we see that, you know, I personally get even influenced with the maid who come to my house. I have a maid who, since I was young, for 35 years, she's been serving my household. 35 years. I've seen her work with a smile on her face. 35 years, dot 11 o'clock, she's there at our house to start with her work. That's the kind of contact she has. Why is she able to do what she does? Because possibly she loves what she does. Believe you me, friends, the delta that you get, the increment that you get, the growth that you get in life is only achieved when you are in complete love with what you do. Recently, you know, pre-pandemic, you know, I stay in a suburb called Ghatkopar in Mumbai. People who are from Mumbai would know that, you know, I stay in a city of Mumbai from a suburb called Ghatkopar. Every day pre-pandemic, I used to take public transport because it used to save a huge amount of time for me. And I used to take metro from Ghatkopar to Andheri. One of the days I was traveling by auto rickshaw from my house to a metro station. And, you know, I sat in one of the auto rickshaws, which had some amazing infrastructure created in the auto rickshaw, something that I had never seen in my life. I have a small video. If I'm allowed, I would like to play a small 1 minute video of that auto rickshaw. I hope it's visible now.
Yes, it is.
When I see this list, I was totally amazed and was in wow with what this guy has created. This is the first rickshaw that gives first kilometer free to all the senior citizens. It has a smartphone charging. It has a internet connectivity. It has a Bluetooth music. It has a pure drinking water available in the auto rickshaw, a cooler fan. And on top of it, the rickshaw guy also gives the fitness advice. He himself was so very fit. He said, I can give a fitness advice to anyone. And you guys would see that it had a wash basin also, just in case if someone wants to, you know, wash anything inside whilst traveling in an auto rickshaw. There is a reason, friend, why I have shown you this video, you know, a small guy, an auto rickshaw driver. But please understand, if he puts his heart and soul in what he does, and if he enjoys what he does, clearly the kind of delta. So I was generally chatting, you know, normally kitna bana lete rickshaw wale? Let's say 1,000 rupees per day banate honge. Ye main baat kar raha hu, three saal pehle ki, pre-pandemic ki baat kar raha hu. And this guy used to make 1,800 rupees a day. Why was he able to do a significantly higher income than other? Because people, he used to connect with his consumer. He used to connect with his customers. And usually, he used to tell me that almost 20-25 days in a month, his rickshaw is really pre-booked. Once the customer connects, the kind of delta, the incremental revenue that you get is enormous. So very important. So friends, my humble advice to you would be that whether you get into your own business, whether you pursue your career with any of the corporate, so very important that you sit back, relax, take time to be completely decisive of what you wish to do. There are n number of options available in today's market. Very important. I still recollect, you know, when I was a child coming from a traditional Gujarati family, you know, my mom, I was a very average student, friends. My mom used to always tell me, ki yaar, padhai nahi karega to kya nai ka kaam karega, you know, matlab padhai kar warna hajamat ki dukaan tujhe kholni padegi. But progressively I realized that there's no harm in that, you know, because today the world is full of opportunity. Let me give you a couple of examples, you know, of two women that I have admired the most. You'll have umpteen number of examples and stories on the internet about successful men and women. But when I was, you know, doing my schooling, my undergraduation in 80s and 90s, I really admired these two young women then who were born pre-independence, but have made amazing success stories only by pursuing the passion that they were interested in. One lady is Tarla Dalal, born in the year 1936, pre-independence, married at an early age. After having kids, she chose very good with Gujarati cuisine. Tarla Dalal is credited with, today we see the kind of name and the fame that people get into this market. You know, we have this famous Kukri show, I'm forgetting the name of that. But Tarla Dalal is someone who made Kukri famous in the 60s and 70s. She has more than 100 books credited to her name, and she could really create a huge business empire only by creating that book for the recipes. Second lady that I could think of is this lady called Shehnaz Hussain. I'm sure you guys possibly would have heard of Shehnaz herbal organic stuff that she sells. Believe you me, amazing success story that she has. A young girl coming in from a traditional Muslim family. She got married at the age of 15, had kids at the age of 16, but never left her passion. She always had this passion of making something big on the herbal cosmetic. After marrying, after getting kids, she went abroad for her studies, blended that international study with Indian traditional Ayurveda, and look at what kind of international brand that she has created. Point, friends, that I'm trying to make is that no matter how long it takes, it's so very important in our careers, whether we take up our own business or we take up a professional career. So very important that you need to love what you do. Talking of myself, I did not land up a job in equity research, something that I had always loved, something for which I did my MBA. To pursue a career in equity research, unfortunately, life had something else planned. But I always worked with plan B. I had that entrepreneurial kida in me. So I fortunately got an opportunity to work with the organization who always supported the new business ideas and allowed the entrepreneur within me to strive to give me a business which has a complete P&L responsibility. So Guru Mantra one, friends, it's important that you guys do what you doing. Extremely important. Please be mindful of that fact. Second point is that whatever you guys decide to do, ensure that that has a addressable market share. It has a fairly big amount of addressable market share, because no matter what you do, whether you start up your own business or you get into a particular organization, it's important that the organization that you get yourself associated with has a fairly large addressable market. What I mean by that is that when you have a large addressable market, it gives you enough room for growth. And it's only when the organization grow, de facto, you would grow along with the growth of the organization. And the reason why I presented you with the film industry dynamics is that you guys would see or would have seen that India is one of the most underscreened nation in the world. What does it mean? It means that we are still scratching the surface, and for next decades to come, clearly there is no stopping. Whilst the market internationally, whether it's in Europe, US, which has 80-120 screens per million of population, maybe that markets have matured. But anyone wanting to make his or her career with the film industry, with the cinema industry, has a huge addressable market, because this country would continue to grow because the per capita consumption is so very low. When ZTV started as a two-hour channel in October 1992, there was hardly anything. But it was the growth of the broadcasting infrastructure which has given rise to the content creators across the length and breadth of the country. And the fact of the matter remains that today we have more than 300 channels running 24/7. So someone making the content. Our chairman from Zee Telephones, Mr. Subhash Chandra, used to famously tell that लोग एक वक्त का खाना खाना रह सकता है, बट बिना एंटरटेनमेंट के कोई नहीं रह सकता. एंड टुडे वी सी द काइंड ऑफ एक्सप्लोशन दैट एंटरटेनमेंट हैज सीन. यू नो, टुडे एवरेज इंडियन स्पेंड्स ऑलमोस्ट 35 आवर्स अ वीक विद द हैंडहेल्ड डिवाइसेस कंज्यूमिंग वन और द अदर फॉर्म ऑफ एंटरटेनमेंट. so very important that the business that you guys choose, the company that you choose, the industry that you choose has to have a significant addressable market. Your growth would de facto be stupendous when you become part of the industry which has a huge addressable market. Third mantra that I feel is very important is to focus on execution. Believe you me, always, no matter what you do in your life, execution is the key. No matter what kind of innovative idea that you have, no kind of brilliant ideas that you have, if you falter with the execution of it, no idea would ever work. Where to focus on execution? That's the third mantra that I have always followed in my life. And fourth, and the last thing that I would want to say is, constantly innovate to stay relevant in the market, you know, in this ever-changing world. Let's talk of PVR, why go elsewhere? PVR is traditional brick and mortar company, which is in the business of showcasing movies to all the audiences all across. But what the reason why PVR has attained what it has attained over a period of time is that one thing that PVR has constantly done is to innovate. The customer centricity is at the core of our heart with anything that we decide. We have stayed with the time. If the times have moved to digital, we have ensured that our customer connects, customer engagement activities are completely there on the digital platform. We have launched PVR loyalty card where we have 12 million PVR loyalty card members. We are across all the social media platforms where we connect with millions of our customers on a regular basis. So it's very important for you guys to ensure that no matter you guys would complete your studies and soon get into business or the corporate field. But one needs to constantly innovate. Otherwise, it would be tough to stay relevant in the highly competitive world. Learning is something which should never stop. Like Mr. Ratan Tata once very famously said, it's important that you break up your life into three equal parts. You got to divide your life into three equal parts. The first phase of your life is what he famously called a learning phase. The second phase of your life is the earning phase. And the third phase of your life is the returning phase, which is where whatever you gained from the society, I think somewhere it's our moral duty to give it back to the society. Now, learning, which is the first phase of your life, it should not stop. No matter you may get tomorrow, right now you're in the learning phase of your career, in the learning phase of your life. Tomorrow you will get into the earning phase. But learning is something which should stay continuously. Have that open frame of mind to learn newer things. Believe me, in today's day and age, if you don't constantly innovate, if you're not eager to learn enough and learn new things which is happening around you, it would be so very difficult to stay relevant in today's day and age particularly. So, Dr. Padalkar, that's it from my side. Would be happy to have any questions that you or any of the students may have on this.
That's wonderful. And that was a great insight into the difficult films and spoken truly from heart. Students, the chats are open. You can fire away your questions. But let me begin by asking one question from my own. In past, movie theaters used to be great places to hang out for families. They were outings. There was a sense of adventure. Whole family going out to book the ticket, then going for the movie show, etc. Then the Coca-Cola that you drink, etc.
Right.
Now in pandemic, we have seen the rise of Netflix, Amazon Prime, etc. The OTT platforms, right? Is this irreversible? Is there something big going on? And what does it mean for future professionals?
Very good question, Dr. Padalkar. So, in my opinion, the Netflix and the Amazon Prime, the whole OTT basket is here to stay. Not that this basket did not exist pre-pandemic. This basket was very much there, not only but internationally as well. In my opinion, both the traditional brick and mortar exhibition space, the whole OTT basket would coexist. What this whole pandemic has done over last 18 months is that it has accelerated the whole pace of digitization in the country. The number of people or the number of subscribers that ideally any of the OTT players would have forecasted, I think this whole pandemic has been to the advantage of OTT players and has accelerated what they would have possibly would have envisaged the subscriber growth to happen over a period of 3 years. Maybe they've got that subscriber addition in last one and a half year. But that having said, we are all social beings. We are not confined, we are not designed to stay within the four walls of our houses, you know. We love to go out of our house. We love to interact with our friends, families. It's like saying that just because there is a rise of the online food aggregators like the Zomato and the Swiggy of the world, would that be the end of restaurant? The answer is big no. Restaurants are open in Gaon, restaurants are open in Mumbai, and we see the kind of capacity utilization that the restaurants are seeing. In fact, in weekends, Mumbai, you go to any dining restaurant, and believe you me, Dr. Padalkar, you will not get a space to eat out in any of the fine dining restaurants. Similarly, coming to our business, I strongly believe that there is nothing which would take away the big screen experience. And the fact that we have such a less theatrical infrastructure, the fact that out of country, which has a population size of 130 odd crore people, the fact that India today sells only 140 crore tickets with great storytellers, for a country with huge film buffs, I think 1.1 ticket per Indian per annum is something that we are still scratching the surface. I believe that this industry has miles to go, and I don't have any doubt that this industry would continue to grow leaps and bounds going forward.
So does it mean a lot of careers for our students, and what kind of careers?
All the fields, you know. So the core, so business has actually become very experiential, you know. Our what has been at the core of PVR is that any customer who walks into the PVR property, we need to entice, we need to wow that customer. Tomorrow, if Dr. Padalkar was to visit any of the PVR cinema in Gurgaon, he should say that yaar film mein maza nahi aaya but yaar PVR mein jaake maza aa gaya. You know, atithi satkar is something which has always been at the core of our heart. Any person, what we have started recently in all the PVR properties is what we call it as a proactive delightful engagement. It's our way of connecting with our customers. The moment a customer walks in, you know, small little things, doctor, that you do, you know, namaskar with a band, welcoming our guest with the smile on the face, talking, interacting with our customers, both on the digital as well as, I call it phygital, which is physical as well as digital platform. But tomorrow, it's the whole experience that you get to see at any of the PVR properties, which should create that wow factor, that yaar, film mein maza nahi tha, but PVR ki property mein aake maza ho gaya, dil khush ho gaya. I would next time also plan my 3-hour outing. And where else would you get a 3-hour outing for 200 rupees ticket price to spend in the kind of ambience and the air conditioned environment that PVR has to provide all across?
Absolutely.
I have one of the question from Khushal Yadav. Can you once again tell me, for example, a movie A is released and I pay 200 for its ticket, and at last, what goes in the pocket of PVR? Okay. So, Khushal, when you pay 200 rupees for a movie ticket, first and foremost, out of that 200 rupees, there is a component which is a tax component. That tax component is nothing but the GST component. Earlier, entertainment tax used to be for donkey's years, you know, as long as cinemas have been into existence. Cinemas and the tax was always a state government subject. from 1st July 2017, when the government introduced GST, which is goods and service tax, our industry is subject to paying GST on the cinema tickets as well. So out of the 200 rupees that you pay to PVR, first 18% of that, markdown is about 15.5%. That goes equally between state GST and central GST. Let's say, hypothetically speaking, out of the 200 rupees that you paid, 30 rupees out of that 200 rupee goes to the towards tax, towards GST. So we are left with 170 rupees. Traditionally, I'm not getting into the nitty-gritties. Traditionally, in India, we have an equal sharing system. Out of the net 170 rupees, which is net of GST, 50% goes, roughly it's 45%, 45 to 50% goes to the copyright owner, to the film producer, to the film distributors, and PVR gets to remain the remaining 50-55%. So out of remaining 170 rupees, PVR would roughly have about, I would reckon, 85 to 90 rupees out of that 170 rupees. I hope that answers your question.
I think it does. Another question is, you know, making a film is a risky venture, and producing a film and distributing it really requires close working relationship between the producer and the distributor, such as your chain of cinemas.
Correct.
Can you tell us how this works in terms of financing and risk reduction?
So, long back, Dr. Saab, we were not even given the status of the industry, which is the reason why a lot of the film producers used to have access to finance from the unorganized sectors, which is bank was refraining from lending to this sector. But fortunately, with the development of multiplexes, with the sector being given the status of the industry, and with more organized players getting into this field, now you see a lot of corporates, both on the exhibition side of the business as well as on the production side of business. So they have good access to the organized way. So banks are more than willing to lend money. If tomorrow any one of you wish to make a movie, you make a project report, there are insurance companies which will give you insurance cover, and hence technically mitigating the risk. Good thing is that the stars have become extremely professional, you know. So gone are those days when, you know, the Yash Raj used to make one movie every 3 years. Now every year they make 5-6 movies, because star also are equally committed to the film assignment that they've taken. So tomorrow, if you were to sign Akshay Kumar, he would usually do next movie after completing your movie, you know. So there are strict clauses, there are agreements which are to be followed. So industry has become much more organized. And as a copyright owner, you know, of course, it's a field full of creativity. You need to have the right blend of creative minds to make the film content. But once you make the film content, today there are multiple ways of monetizing that content, which was not present earlier. Today, the same film can be made available across multiple platforms. The right way of monetizing the content would be to first exhibit the movie in the theatrical circuit. Once you milk the product completely, as the film has seen its run in the exhibition, then you take the same movie to the broadcasters, which is the Z-Star Sony of the world. Then the same movie is exhibited across multiple digital platforms, which is the OTT. And plus you have the digital video rights, you have international distribution rights, you have music rights, you have various ancillary rights, small areas, like, you know, there is something called as in-flight entertainment. You can give your content to the Vistaras of the world, who would also pay you depending on what kind of viewership that they have. So the good thing is that this is the best time for the content creators, and it's the copyright that is being created, which will forever give you some kind of revenue. Today you've given the rights to ZTV for 5 years. Chances are, if the content is good, if it has seen good eyeballs on the digital media, you would be able to monetize the content even after 5 years by reselling the same rights to any of the broadcasters going forward.
Couple more questions from students. Nishant saying, are you enjoying your job?
Oh, absolutely. I would not have been in this job if I would not have been enjoying this. The good thing why I enjoy my job is that I have a complete business responsibility. You know, there was always an entrepreneur within me which wanted to start up my own business. Of course, startup would have needed a huge amount of capital. Here, I think God has been kind enough that it gave me a platform as big as PVR. And even in my previous organization, you know, almost last 15, 16 years of my professional career, I've only headed business which has a P&L responsibility. So anything which has a responsibility, I thoroughly love enjoying it. And second, what I love enjoying is when I get an opportunity to start things from scratch, I think the kind of kick, the adrenaline push that you get when you are associated with a business where you get the opportunity of starting things from scratch, you know, where you get, it's like a growth business where you get a growth capital, you start your own vertical, you create your own team, you create your own brand, and right from scratch, taking that business to its maturity, believe me, there is nothing more satisfying than that. Kushal has asked another question, sir, if the movie does not work, how does cinema cover its loss? Fortunately, we don't cover any kind of losses, Kushal. But at the same time, when the movie does exceptionally well, we don't get the upside as well. We are in the business where we share the pains and gains equally. So it's an equal sharing. So if a movie is a hit, we both producers and exhibitors share the box office collections equally. Tomorrow, if the movie, unfortunately, we don't recoup any kind of losses. But the producers are generally mindful of that. You know, they don't make as much of losses because there are multiple ways of monetizing it. They would be pre-selling tomorrow if you make a... Because making movies, see, it's a very creative stuff. So if you ask me to make a cinema, it's a very capital-intensive business. For me to make a cinema, typically I end up spending anywhere between 3 to 4 crore per screen on the fit-outs, on creating the theatrical infrastructure. But when it comes to creating a movie, you can make a movie as low as 5 crore budget, or maybe you can make a Bahubali at a budget of 500 crores. So the money involved in making the content is diverse, and the way of monetizing is multiple. So it's up to the content creators how he wants to, what kind of money, what kind of scale he wants to make the movie. We don't, we are not partners in loss when it comes to the movie business.
We're almost at the 3 p.m. mark, so I guess I will ask my last question.
Sure, sir.
Anything you learned after you started working which were not taught to you during your formal education?
Quite a few of them. One thing that I always see it as a gap, doctor, is, you know, for example, you know, I mean, I belong to a generation where we were not given enough guidance, enough training. Whilst I was pursuing my management, I was not given enough training in terms of, so let's say if I was doing my master's with specialization in finance, what would happen when I complete my studies and I go in the large corporate jungle, you know. So when I took up my job in June 1998, I, for first few months, I felt lost in like a huge corporate jungle, you know, not knowing what to do. And I always had that thing, had the inclination that I wish if my curriculum, if my studies had something, you know, which would have taught me the tricks of the trade in terms of how the corporate would work. I'll give you a very small example. You know, when I took up my first job in ZTele Films, I was in finance department. My job was to make MIS for all the SL group of companies. Now, I had to do a lot of on-the-job learning because my educational background then did not teach me that how to make MIS reports. How to make analytical studies when you are presented with the plethora of Excel sheets and the information. How to make a meaningful, logical reasoning out of those reports is something which was not taught to me at that point in time. It was all very bookish kind of a knowledge. So I had completely on-the-job learning. But my advice to the students, and I believe in the North Cape University, you have all the undergraduates pursuing either law, engineering, or management. Fortunately, you know, one good thing which I had, which none of the other MBA colleges then had, was that I had a wonderful professor, wonderful dean who had, I remember his name, Professor Sandeep Desai was the dean in the 90s of our university. And he, during those days when the education was all about academics, we used to have 4 lectures a day, Dr. Saab, about 3 hours each, with a gap of 15 minutes between the 2 lectures and stuff like that. So he broke up the entire curriculum. He said, let's do one thing. 75% would be academics, 25% would be non-academics. In non-academics, all the internal exams, I still remember giving my law exam in Aksa Beach, and which was an open book exam, and professor, the dean of the university, was absolutely okay. In fact, he motivated people to do so. What he institutionalized the process is that one day in a week, he used to call all the industry leaders to our campus, and industry leaders used to share their on-ground experiences. I think that really helped us as a student. It really helped us to know the whole corporate culture, and to hear things from the horse's mouth, I think really helped us shape the career. But coming to your point, it's so very important, students, that you spend some time with the corporate learning, because let's say you want to become a law graduate. Now, what next after you complete your graduation? Maybe you may want to do your master's, you may want to take up a job, you may want to start up something on your own and stuff like that. Now, within law also, it's such a wide field, you know, whether you want to become a legal expert in criminal law, corporate law, real estate. I mean, there are multiple things associated with it. PVR as an organization, you know, there is a room for all the kind of fields, you know. We deal, 850 screens across the country, 175 plus real estate. We today have more than 1 crore square feet of real estate, Dr. Saab. Just imagine the kind of legal contract and the regular interactions that we would have with this developer. And we obviously would need the legal resource to help us draft this agreement. And PVR is an organization which is in a growth phase. So not only is a regular interaction with the existing set of developers, every week we have new set of contract which we'll be signing with the new developer, developing some property in some part of the country. So a law graduate with specialization on the real estate side, he or she should know how to make the real estate contract. These are typically rental contract, you know, leave and license agreement, long-term lease contract that you do for the real estate business. Very much welcome. Second most important part, as the business is getting digital, you know, earlier in the 90s, almost 100% of the tickets used to be sold over the counter. In fiscal 1920, PVR sold more than 10 crore tickets in that financial year. Out of that 10 crore tickets, 55% of those tickets were sold online. When I say online, it was through PVR web, PVR app, our aggregator partners like Paytm and BookMyShow and stuff like that. Now, this shows that if 55% of the people are transacting online, there is a huge universe. So clearly, from a digital marketing perspective, and Dr. Saab in the introductory speech did mention about augmented reality, artificial intelligence, digital marketing. Friends, clear, this is the future. So even in the PVR ecosystem, all the new recruits that we onboard, particularly on the marketing side, our clear focus area is to get younger minds, which has a larger thirst and understanding of the digital marketing, because the kind of connect that we have with our customer, you know, we have 1.2 loyalty customer base who transact regularly on the online platforms. We have huge amount of millions of people who interact on a daily basis about which movie is running, what's the story, what's the contest, what's the kind of offers, and everything, believe you me, is happening online, either through Facebook, Insta, Twitter and stuff like that. The kind of marketing repository that we have, it's largely people who have a blend towards digital marketing than the traditional marketing. Even the spend perspective, I see organization reducing the spend on the traditional medium and increasing the spend on the digital medium, because clearly the younger generation has a larger connect. They spend more time on the digital mediums. That's where we believe that the larger connect would happen going forward.
That's a wonderful chat we have had so far. Time is not our friend.
Right.
It's 7 minutes past three. So we will actually close the session here, but we would like to see more of you in future. Once this COVID blows over, probably you can visit us, or we will get together in one way or the other, because there is enough, I can see enough areas of, you know, give and take and mutual interest between a university and the house of PVR. So on behalf of Northcap University, I must thank you wholeheartedly for sharing your views and your insights with our students. And thank you very much and all the best.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for having me for this session. Thank you. Really appreciate it. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.